Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Ghost and the Baby by Bobbi Holmes and Anna J. McIntyre. Narrated by Romy Nordlinger. 1. Daisy Fay Morden stood in her bedroom on the second floor, looking down at the street from the corner windows. To her right was Marlow House, vacant since she was 3 years old. She had no memory of anyone ever living there, yet she had met its owner 2 years earlier when Brianna O'Malley had come to inspect the property. O'Malley had been practically a girl at the time, the same age as Daisy was now. Turning her attention to the street, she spied the postman walking toward her house. Her father had made a point of telling her not to leave the house today until the mail arrived. If there had been somewhere she wanted to go, she would have made up some excuse for her father about why she hadn't waited. Yet she had nowhere to go this morning, plus he had piqued her curiosity, especially after that unfortunate incident when he had walked in on her and her gentleman friend borrowing his office. It was his own fault, she thought. After all, her father was supposed to be in Portland that day. Between the shouts, Daisy had reminded her father that she was no longer a girl. But it wasn't just the compromising position that had infuriated him. It was the other man's age. "Old enough to be your father," Elmer Morton had roared. Daisy found that quite hypocritical, considering what the age difference had been between her own parents. As for the fact the man was much older than her, that was hardly her fault. After all, most of the eligible men were off at war. There was, of course, her sister's beau, Kenneth Bakken, who had just been released from the army, returning home with a missing leg. There was also Daisy's old beau, Louis Sampson, who was 4F and was unable to serve his country. Just as the postman started up her walkway, Daisy darted from the room and headed downstairs to answer the door. She was alone in the house. Her only sibling, Maisie Fay, was at some boring Red Cross meeting, and her father was at work. When she threw open the front door a few minutes later, the postman had just stepped up onto the porch and was about to ring the bell.
"Good morning," he greeted her. "Is it Daisy or Maisie?"
"I'm Daisy," she said brightly, playfully snatching the mail from his hands and sending her blonde curls bobbing. "Remember? I'm the pretty one." He laughed at her comment, not because she wasn't pretty, but because she and her sister Maisie were identical twins. Several minutes later, Daisy was alone again in the entry hall, sorting through the mail, wondering what her father thought so important about today's delivery. In the stack of mail, there was only one envelope addressed to her, and curiously, the return address was her father's attorney. Staring at the unopened letter, Daisy frowned. Why is he sending me something? After tossing the rest of the mail on the entry table, Daisy hastily opened the envelope addressed to her and pulled out the letter. She began to read.
"No," she shouted a moment later. "He can't do this."
Angrily clutching the letter in her right hand, she looked frantically around the entry hall, trying to figure out how to get to the funeral home, cursing her sister for taking the car today. She needed to straighten this out with her father, now, and it was not something she could do on the phone, nor could she wait for him to come home tonight. Daisy briefly considered calling Louis and asking him to drive her to the funeral home, but then she would have to tell him why, and knowing Louis, he wouldn't stop until he got the truth. One thing she hated about Louis, he could always see through her lies. Of course, that never stopped him from pursuing her. She couldn't tell him what was in the letter. She needed to fix this before anyone found out. The only option, she would have to walk to the funeral home. Hastily, she slipped on her jacket and hat, grabbed her handbag, and shoved the attorney's letter into her jacket pocket. Leaving her house a few minutes later, she angrily made her way down the street, replaying in her mind the contents of the letter. If she had a gun, she would be sorely tempted to shoot her father. Yet the only problem, she realized it was too late for that. On the bright side,
If she managed to fix this, she could always shoot him later, a thought she found somewhat comforting. Morton Funeral Home was located on the south side of Frederickport in a large two-story Victorian. Elmer Morton had lived in the house with his first wife, and after she had died and he met his second wife, he moved into the house next door to Marlow House, where he had raised his two daughters, Daisy and Maisie. Slightly out of breath from the brisk walk, Daisy stood outside the funeral home and looked up to the second floor and the window of her father's office. She knew he was alone, considering his newly hired assistant was off sick, and the woman who helped in the office didn't work on Wednesdays, and there were no strange cars parked out front. Digging one hand in her coat pocket, she took hold of the crumpled letter and then made her way up the walk. The front door was not locked. It never was during business hours. As soon as she opened the door, bells jingled, heralding her arrival. The moment she stepped inside, the scent of lilies overwhelmed her and she cringed. Since she was a small child, she loathed the smell of lilies, although she had to admit it smelled better than the embalming room. Shivering at the thought, she closed the door behind her, sending the bells on another jingle. Daisy was about to call out for her father when he came walking into the entry from a nearby room. He halted abruptly when he saw her.
"What are you doing here?"
he asked. Elmer Morton looked more like her grandfather than father, with his white hair and deeply creased face and slight hunched build. Wearing a dark suit befitting a mortician and solemn expression, he looked unkindly at his daughter. Pulling the letter from her pocket, she waved it at him and said,
"What do you think?"
"I assume that is the letter from my attorney," he asked calmly.
Crumpling the letter into a ball, she threw it at him. It landed at his feet.
"How could you?"
He looked down at the ball of paper, making no attempt to pick it up. He looked back to Daisy and asked,
"Shouldn't you be at home packing?"
"And just where am I supposed to go?"
He shrugged.
"It's not really my problem, is it? As you told me, you are an independent woman. Now you can prove it."
"Of course your favorite Maisie doesn't have to move out," she hissed.
"Maisie has always behaved like a lady. I am tired, Daisy. Tired of your endless antics and vulgar behavior. It's over. You have what you've always wanted, your independence."
"And just like that, you've written me out of your will?" she fumed. "How could you?"
"I wouldn't get too excited about it. I don't plan to go anywhere right away. And the doctor tells me I'm in relatively good health. So perhaps if you can learn to restrain yourself and prove to me you are capable of acting not just as an independent woman, but a responsible one with some semblance of morals, then maybe you will one day be written back in. But that day is not now."
Red-faced, she glared at her father and immediately recognized his resolve. After a moment of silence, she said,
"Fine. Write me out of the will until I prove I can be respectable enough for you. But why do I need to move out of our house?"
"It's my house, Daisy, not yours. And I don't want you there anymore. As the letter stated, you have 1 week to move out."
"Move out where? And how am I supposed to pay for a place to live?"
"I would assume an independent woman would get a job. That's normally how it's done. Or perhaps you could just marry your current beau." "Oh, that's right. He doesn't have a job, does he?"
Elmer turned from Daisy and started down the hallway toward the staircase.
"Where are you going?" she demanded.
"I have work to do. Go home and pack your things," he told her without looking back.
Stunned, she watched her father walk away. Just as he started up the stairs, she ran after him.
"Wait, Father, please. Can we discuss this?" she begged.
"I'm done arguing with you," he said wearily, continuing up the staircase, his back to her.
"You can't just throw me out like this. I'm your daughter."
Go home and start looking for a job, he told her, still walking up the stairs. You'll need one if you're going to find a place to move into before I have you evicted. I'd hate for you to have to live on the streets.
You can't be serious!
She rushed up the steps after him. Just as he was about to step onto the second floor landing, she grabbed the back of his jacket, wanting him to stop and look at her. Unprepared for the physical contact, Elmer stumbled and lost his balance. Just as he started to fall, Daisy reached out to catch him, but his shoe slipped on the edge of the stairs, accelerating the momentum of the fall. Had Daisy not grabbed hold of the handrail, she too would be toppling down the stairs with her father. His arms flailed in all directions as he tried to grab hold of something, anything to break the fall. Daisy watched in morbid fascination as her father plummeted downward until his head hit the first floor landing. She could hear his skull crack just before blood began spilling onto the carpet. Dazed, Daisy walked slowly down the stairs, her eyes riveted to her father's seemingly lifeless body. She couldn't believe what she was seeing. Once she reached the first floor landing, she knelt by his side and took hold of one wrist, feeling for a pulse. Nothing. Panicked, she rolled him over onto his back and looked down at his lifeless face. He was dead. She just stared at him a moment. Instead of tears, anger welled up inside her. "You stupid old man," she hissed. "How could you do this? I don't want you dead. What am I going to do now? I didn't think it was possible to hate you as much as I do. But at this moment, I've never hated you more. You stupid, stupid, clumsy old man." Daisy rolled him back over, placing him in the same position he had been in after he had fallen down the stairs. She then ran down the hall and picked up the letter she had thrown at her father. Shoving it in her pocket, she turned one final time to look at his dead body. After hurling a final curse in his direction, she slipped out of the funeral home and started back to Beach Drive, doing what she could not to be seen. The last thing she needed right now was for anyone to know she had been with her father when he had fallen down the stairs. Considering what his attorney had sent her today, someone might believe she had pushed her father down the stairs in a fit of anger. But that was not what had happened, she told herself. He had fallen down the stairs on his own. She only wished it had happened a week earlier. 2. Pearl Huckabee stood in her bedroom on the second floor, looking down at the street from the corner windows. To her right was Marlow House, vacant when she had been a child. It was vacant now, at least it had been for the last 2 weeks. From what Pearl understood, Walt and Danielle Marlow were in Hawaii on their honeymoon and would be returning any day now. She smiled in satisfaction, knowing they were in for a surprise when they returned home. It had taken dogged persistence, but Pearl had managed to find a way to end the influx of strangers coming and going next door. If the Marlows had any reservations, they would be forced to cancel them when they returned home. Marlow House Bed and Breakfast was out of business. Walt and Danielle just didn't know it yet. Motion from her yard caught her attention. Pearl looked down and spied the black cat from next door sitting in the middle of her flower bed, looking up at her. As his gaze met hers, he quietly did his business and then covered it with soil before sauntering off to his own yard. If she didn't know better, Pearl would swear the demon cat had just defiantly used her garden as a litter box while daring her to do something about it. "You little monster!" Pearl hissed. She turned from the window and headed downstairs. It hadn't been the first time she had caught the Marlowe's cat using her yard in such a disgusting manner. She didn't know who they had left in charge of the animal, but whoever it was, they certainly weren't monitoring its whereabouts. After talking to Danielle about her pet, Pearl had stopped seeing it in her yard. But just days after they left for their honeymoon, the pest showed up in her garden again. Yet it was always when she was upstairs. It was almost as if the cat knew she would be unable to do anything when on the second floor. After several days of watching the cat use her yard from her bedroom window, she decided to outsmart the animal. Pearl had set up a cage-like trap in her yard, baited with tuna, sure to attract the annoying feline. Once in the cage, she planned to haul it down to a shelter in another town. If she took him to the shelter in Frederickport, Danielle would be sure to get the little monster back. Yet each morning when she went to check the cage, the tuna was gone, and so was the cat. It was as if someone was releasing the animal from the cage before she could get to it. As Pearl stormed downstairs, she decided to take care of the menacing feline once and for all. After all, she took care of the bed and breakfast, didn't she? Pearl figured if she didn't act now, then once Walt and Danielle returned, it would be too late to do anything. Before going outside, she grabbed a pillowcase from the laundry room. She figured she could shove the little beast in the pillowcase, and it shouldn't be too hard to carry it back to her house, shove him and the pillowcase into the cage, and then get rid of him once and for all. Going outside, she grabbed hold of the cage trap and began dragging it toward the wrought iron fencing separating her yard from Marlow House. There was a loose section she could squeeze through. Leaving the cage on her side of the property line, she slipped through the opening, pillowcase in hand. There was no shortage of friends willing to feed Max while Walt and Danielle were on their honeymoon. Lily and Ian were just across the street. Heather was one door over, and Chris lived down the road. Any of them would have been likely candidates. Even Joanne had offered to stop by, yet it was Marie who had been given the task. She enjoyed feeling needed, and it gave her the opportunity to practice her newly acquired levitating skills. As it turned out, Marie was a good choice because she had become something of a night owl in her death, which allowed her to keep a closer eye on Max's antics. Marie had also offered to bring in the mail, but it was decided envelopes floating up from the mailbox to the front door might shake up some of the neighbors. Therefore, Lily and Ian assumed that chore. Wearing a new sundress, something she had seen in one of the local dress shop windows and had managed to duplicate, Marie sat at the kitchen table and watched as Max entered through the pet door. The moment he spied her sitting there, he stopped in his tracks and sat down, the metal pet door swinging closed behind him. Arching her brows, she said, "I saw what you did over there." Max let out a meow and then stood up and sauntered over to the food bowl Marie had just filled. "Maybe you won't listen to me, but when Walt and Danielle get home, I'm going to tell them what shenanigans you have been up to." Max, who had just started to eat, paused a moment and looked back at Marie. "Don't look at me like that," she scolded. "If it weren't for me, you would still be in that cage, and who knows where she would have taken you." Max stared at Marie for a moment longer and then resumed eating. Marie rolled her eyes. "I suppose I should be flattered that you had faith in me. But Max, I might not be around the next time you find yourself trapped in a cage. And if I counted correctly, she had you trapped 8 times." Max looked back to Marie and meowed again. Marie shook her head. "Oh, pshaw, it wasn't the challenge you liked, it was the tuna." The next moment, the pet door flew open and a head popped in the kitchen. It was Pearl Huckabee from next door. "Oh, there you are, you little monster," Pearl said in a soft, sing-song voice. "Come here, kitty, kitty." "What is she doing here?" Marie gasped. Of course, Pearl couldn't see Marie. Unlike many of the neighbors on Beach Drive, she couldn't see ghosts. Max stopped eating and turned to face the door. He looked from Marie to the gray-haired head sticking in the kitchen through the pet door. "You stay right there," Marie warned Max. He started to take a step toward Pearl when Marie snapped, "You heard me, Max. Unless you want to be levitated to the ceiling." Max froze. He hated to be levitated. Marie narrowed her eyes and looked back to Pearl, who continued her attempt to coax the cat to her.
I should have brought some tuna, Pearl grumbled under her breath as Max stared at her, refusing to budge.
You're trying to catnap Max, Marie blurted.
She then paused and considered what she had just said.
Kidnap? Catnap? No, that doesn't work, she mumbled, and then rephrased. You're trying to steal Max.
Focusing on the swinging pet door resting on the top of Pearl's head, Marie willed it to open wider. It slowly moved up until it lay flat against the door, unnoticed by the intruding neighbor. The next moment, it slammed down atop Pearl's head.
Ouch!
Pearl yelped, inadvertently slamming her head back against the pet door's wooden frame. The metal flapping door slapped against the top of her head again and again. Now in a panic, Pearl managed to wiggle her head from the opening. Once her entire body and self were back outside, Pearl turned from Marlow House and ran as fast as she could to the section of fence she had crawled through. In her hasty departure, she dropped the pillowcase on the back porch, leaving it there. Sticking her head outside, literally through the door, Marie watched Pearl run back into her yard after squeezing through the loose section of fence. Looking down at the abandoned pillowcase, Marie willed it up off the ground and into the house, through the pet door. Once the pillowcase was in the house, Marie picked it up and said, Walt and Danielle need to see this. She looked back at Max, who had returned to his food. And you need to stay in the house until they get home. She glanced at the kitchen wall clock. They should be home in a couple of hours. Danielle leaned back in the passenger seat and watched as Walt steered her Ford Flex down the highway, heading back to Frederickport from the Portland airport. He wore a white linen shirt and tan slacks, his complexion darker than she had ever seen it, the Hawaiian suntan an alluring contrast to his vivid blue eyes. He looked relaxed, content, and happy, which was how she felt. It had been a magical 2 weeks, and there had been moments during the honeymoon, many of them actually, when she had managed to forget their strange history, and she and Walt were no different than any other newlyweds in love. Of course, they were no more newlyweds than a normal couple, she reminded herself.
I have to say you've become an excellent driver, Danielle said,
her eyes on Walt. Hands on the steering wheel, he glanced over to her and flashed a smile, and then looked back down the road.
I suppose I could remind you that I started driving over 100 years ago. But the truth is, driving is definitely different now.
The traffic? Danielle asked.
That and the paved roads. To be honest, I'm a little surprised you don't have a problem with me driving your car.
We are married, Danielle reminded him. It's technically our car.
Does that make the Packard yours? He asked in a faux pout.
Danielle laughed and then said, Truth is, it's kind of nice not to have to drive.
I thought all modern women like to drive their own cars, he asked.
Danielle shrugged. Maybe I'm getting lazy. Or perhaps I rather like the idea of a handsome, incredibly sexy chauffeur driving me around, she thought, suppressing a giggle.
Walt reached over and gave Danielle's hand a pat. It's that island lifestyle. Hawaii in person was even better than a dream hop.
I had such a good time, Danielle said with a sigh. But I have to admit, I'm really looking forward to getting home.
Me too. I hope Max stayed out of trouble.
Yeah, I was a little worried about him, but Marie promised to keep an eye on him.
I think she's rather fond of that cat, Walt said.
Which is interesting, because if I recall, Marie wasn't especially crazy about cats when she was alive.
Back then, she'd never had a real conversation with one, Walt reminded her.
30 minutes later, Walt pulled the car into the garage at Marlow House. He was tempted to levitate the luggage from the garage to the house, but Danielle reminded him the new neighbor had prying eyes, so they hauled the luggage inside the old-fashioned way. Entering through the back door into the kitchen, they were greeted by Marie and Max. Danielle gave Marie a quick summary of their time in Hawaii, and in turn, Marie updated them on Max and their new neighbor.
"She tried to trap him?"
Danielle asked, after Marie finished her telling.
"Max thought it was a great game. He especially loved the tuna."
"Walt, you need to explain to Max that the next time the tuna could be poisoned," Danielle told him.
Walt picked up the pillowcase and looked at it.
"And you think she intended to put Max in this?"
Marie shrugged. "That's my guess, but I chased her off." Walt looked down at Max.
"You and I have to have a talk."
Staring up at Walt, the cat blinked his golden eyes and then jumped into Danielle's arms and began to purr. Marie shook her head and mumbled, "He is a spoiled brat."
Holding Max in her arms, Danielle kissed his head.
"Yes, I suppose he is."
"I promised Eva I would meet her at the theater after you returned home. You'll find your mail piled on the desk in the parlor." A moment later, Marie vanished. With Max in her arms, Danielle followed Walt to the parlor. Once there, she tossed the cat on the sofa and then took a seat at the desk and began sorting through the mail.
"Anything interesting?" Walt asked.
"Mostly bills, but there are a couple of cards from some of my friends from California. I imagine their wedding congratulations."
Danielle stacked the letters and cards in one pile and what looked like bills in another. She then paused and looked at one from the city.
"I wonder what this is," Danielle muttered as she tore open the envelope. Walt glanced up from where he sat on the sofa with Max and noticed Danielle's peculiar expression as she read the letter.
"What is it?" Walt asked.
"It's from the city. Our business license has been revoked."
3.
"Revoked?" Walt asked.
Danielle nodded and stood up from the desk, her attention still on the letter in her hands.
"That's what it says." She walked to the sofa where Walt sat. "Something about a discrepancy with the initial paperwork, and we're to cease and desist until when, or if, we can get the license reinstated."
Walt scooted over on the sofa, pushing Max to one end to make room for Danielle. She sat down next to him and handed him the letter.
"Maybe I should call the chief, see if he knows anything," Danielle suggested. "I really don't want to spend my first day home down at the city office."
"You think he'll know anything?" Walt asked. "It's not really his area."
Danielle stood back up.
"He usually keeps informed of this sort of thing. After all, he needs to know if someone is operating an illegal bed and breakfast," she grumbled.
After walking to the desk, she picked up the handset to the landline and placed the call.
"Hi, Chief."
"Yes, we're back," Danielle said a moment later. She glanced over to Walt, who silently listened to her side of the conversation.
"Yeah, we had a great time. But the reason I'm calling, we just started going through our mail, and we got something from the city."
"What? You knew? Why?
Renton? She what?
Oh, brother, I can't believe this. No, I take that back. Yes, I can. You know that woman was trying to capture Max while we were gone.
I don't know, but she even tried to coax him out of our house. Marie told me.
So is this thing hopeless?
Okay. What is her problem? Doesn't like change?"
"Yeah, no, I understand. Okay. Yeah, I'll tell Walt, and we'll figure out what we want to do."
"Okay. Yeah, talk to you later. Thanks."
Danielle hung up the phone and returned to the sofa with Walt.
"Well?" he asked.
She sat down next to him. "Apparently, when you start a business in a residential area of Frederickport, you have to send a notice to all your neighbors within a specific proximity to the property and notify them of your intentions and then hold a hearing. If any of the neighbors object at the public hearing, then the license can be denied. There was no hearing for Marlow House." Walt frowned.
I don't understand. How did you get the license in the first place? And didn't you know about this before you opened?
Danielle let out a sigh and slumped back on the sofa. Renton handled everything before we arrived.
Renton? You mean the man who murdered Cheryl? The one I hit over the head?
Danielle nodded. Yes, but back then I knew him as my aunt's trusty attorney. What a joke.
If Renton didn't arrange for a public hearing, how did he get you a license?
I guess he took a shortcut and paid someone in the city to sign off on it. I'm sure with my money, not his. At least that's what they suspect. But the employee who handled our business license is no longer with the city. He was fired last year, and there is no record of any public hearing.
I don't understand. Why did all this come up now?
Why do you think? Danielle gave a nod to the south-facing wall. She didn't just have an issue with Max.
The new neighbor? Walt asked.
Yep. According to the chief, she has been down at City Hall asking all sorts of questions about the legalities of running a bed and breakfast. Although she kept referring to it as a motel, in a residential neighborhood. I guess someone down there was tired of her badgering them, so they decided to show her the process, and in doing so discovered a vital step had been skipped when our license was issued. The chief doesn't think the city would have revoked our license over this if our lovely neighbor wasn't making such a big deal out of it. But there was no way for them to sweep this under the carpet. And considering Renton's history, the city understands I probably wasn't aware of his shortcut. But still, I can't operate the B&B without a business license. Walt tossed the letter on the coffee table and wrapped one arm around Danielle's shoulders, pulling her closer.
Ironic, we were just discussing closing the B&B on our flight home.
She leaned against him and let out a sigh. I know, but to be forced to close? That makes me want to keep it open. Walt gave her a little squeeze and then dropped a quick kiss on her head before saying,
But just think, you'll get the last laugh. I don't imagine you'll need a business license for what we were talking about.
Danielle chuckled. Yeah, you're probably right. So maybe this is a sign?
Sign? He asked.
That we go ahead with what we talked about on the way home.
Unless we hold a hearing with the neighbors and hope Pearl doesn't manage to get the license denied, it looks like your bed and breakfast is closed. So we either do nothing or what we discussed, Walt said.
As much as I hate giving up without a fight, I think with everything that has happened, with what we want for our future, then in some ways Pearl Huckabee has made it all easier for me.
Gave you the shove you needed to make up your mind once and for all? Walt asked.
Yeah. Maybe I should go thank her, Danielle chuckled.
I'm sure she would appreciate it, Walt teased.
Kicking off her shoes and propping her stockinged feet on the coffee table, Danielle said, I wonder why she is such an unpleasant woman. According to the chief, that house has been in her family for years, and she bought it from some cousins.
I wonder if she's related to Elmer Morton. That might explain her disposition.
Danielle looked to Walt. Elmer Morton? Who's that?
That's who was living next door, in Pearl Huckabee's house, when I died, Walt explained.
Her maiden name might have been Morton. From what I understand, she's a widow, and Huckabee was her husband's name, Danielle said. So why did you say it might explain her disposition?
Morton and I never got along. He was about my grandfather's age, pious old coot, an avid supporter of prohibition, and I'm pretty sure he was a member of the local clan.
Seems like such an oxymoron,
Walt frowned. In what way?
How can you be pious and belong to an organization like the KKK? Danielle asked.
Walt shrugged. Sadly, it wasn't uncommon.
You've never mentioned him before.
Not much to tell. Morton and I tended to avoid each other, although I imagine he got the last laugh when I died and became a customer.
Danielle frowned. Last laugh?
He owned the local mortuary, Morton Funeral Home.
Morton Funeral Home? It's still here?
Danielle said. The chief mentioned he heard one of Pearl's relatives still lives in Frederickport and was one of the owners who sold the property to her. But he didn't know who it was.
I wonder if it's whoever owns the funeral home now.
It's possible.
I'm assuming Morton had children, if Pearl is one of his descendants, Danielle said. What were they like? Did you know them?
He had twin daughters. They were babies when I died.
Babies? Danielle frowned.
Yes, old man Morton's first wife died in childbirth, giving birth to stillborn twins.
How sad, Danielle murmured. But you said he had twin daughters.
His second wife was much younger. Much. At the time he was courting her, he lived at the funeral home. But from what I heard, she refused to live there.
Well, I can't say I blame her.
Why, you're always hanging out with dead people. Seems like the perfect place for you, he teased.
Danielle playfully elbowed Walt. Oh, hush. Go on with your story.
Max, who had been napping at the end of the sofa, opened his eyes and then jumped down to the floor and sauntered out of the parlor.
Was it something I said? Danielle asked as she watched the cat leave the room.
I think we were making too much noise for him, Walt said.
Danielle rolled her eyes and then turned to Walt. Go on with your story.
Morton bought the house next door. The couple who had lived there had passed away, and it had been vacant for a few years. Not long after that, he moved in with his new bride. She was pregnant right away, and like his first wife, with twins. Sadly, she also died in childbirth. But this time, the babies lived.
Oh my gosh, that's heartbreaking. I hate those kinds of stories, especially with Lily being pregnant.
Lily will be fine, Walt promised, giving Danielle's knee a pat.
I'd like to think childbirth is safe for women these days, but there are still complications.
I don't imagine Lily is going to give birth at home with a midwife, as did both of Morton's wives, Walt said.
And he raised the twins by himself? Danielle asked.
He hired a full-time nanny who moved into the house. Initially, I assumed he would move back to the funeral home with the babies. It would have been more convenient for him. But Catherine O'Malley knew the nanny, and she told me the wife had made her husband promise on her deathbed not to raise her daughters in a funeral home. I guess she was superstitious, and he honored her wishes, at least while I was alive.
Considering the age of Pearl Huckabee, one of the twins could be her grandmother or mother, Danielle speculated. I wonder what happened to them.
I imagine Marie knew them, Walt suggested. They would have been a couple of years older than Marie, but they would have gone to school together.
Funny, when I discussed Pearl with Marie, she didn't seem to know anything about Pearl's family or background.
Walt shrugged. Maybe she just didn't make the connection. After all, it has been a long time.
True. Danielle leaned back against the sofa and quietly considered all that Walt had told her. After a few minutes of silence, Walt asked,
What are you thinking about?
There are no kids on Beach Drive. It's funny to think that back when you lived here, in your first life, there was a baby across the street and two little ones next door. And in a few months, there will be a baby across the street again.
And maybe in the not-so-distant future, a baby on this side of the street.
Walt pulled her onto his lap. Wrapping her arms around her husband, Danielle dropped a quick kiss on his lips and whispered, Remember I said I wanted to be married for at least a year before we start planning babies? And we just came back from our honeymoon.
Walt pulled her closer and returned her kiss,
yet not a quick one as hers had been. His was slower and more deliberate, which she fully appreciated.
When the kiss ended, he whispered, Our one-year anniversary is less than 3 months away.
Danielle gave him an exuberant hug while whispering in his ear, So it is. 4.
Lily Bardley sat alone at her desk in her classroom at the elementary school, correcting spelling papers. The bell had rung 5 minutes earlier, and her students had all left. She didn't have a lot of papers to correct today, and she didn't want to take them home with her. Glancing at the wall clock, she wondered if Walt and Danielle were back in Frederickport yet. Danielle had sent her a text message when they had landed earlier that day at the Portland airport. Just as Lily turned her attention back to the papers before her, she heard a voice call out, "Mrs. Bartley, can I come in?" Lily looked up to the now open door. It was Evan McDonald. She couldn't believe how much he had grown since she had first met him several years earlier. Tall and lanky, taller than any of the other third graders in his class, he had large brown eyes and eyelashes women spent a fortune to have, yet they never looked quite as good as Evan's. He had been one of her students the previous school year, but he had been a friend first, student second. He was also the youngest son of Police Chief McDonald, and like her dear friend Danny, and Walt and Chris and Heather, he could see ghosts.
"Come on in, Evan, and it's after hours, so you can call me Lily."
Evan grinned broadly and walked into the class carrying his backpack.
"I was wondering if you knew if Walt and Danielle were back yet," he asked as he approached her desk.
"Danny sent me a text message about 3 hours ago, telling me they had just landed at the airport, so they might be back home by now."
Standing by Lily's desk, Evan dropped the backpack on the floor and stared at Lily a moment, saying nothing. Lily looked at him curiously.
"Is there something else you wanted to ask me?"
Evan chewed his lower lip and then looked down to the floor.
Never mind, I just wondered if Danielle and Walt were back yet."
A smile tugged at the corners of Lily's mouth as she studied Evan a moment before saying,
"Come on, out with it. I can tell there's something you're dying to ask me. You look like you're about to explode."
He looked up shyly.
I overheard my dad talking. I wasn't supposed to hear."
"And?
Is it true you aren't going to be a teacher anymore?"
"Oh, what else did you hear?" she asked mischievously.
"Are you having a baby?"
Evan asked in a whisper. Lily smiled and reached over and grabbed a nearby chair. She dragged it closer and then motioned for Evan to sit down. He sat down.
"Yes, it is true, but I would appreciate it if you would keep the secret for now. I haven't told my class yet. As for being a teacher, I might be a teacher again. Later, I don't know. But for now, I want to be home with the baby."
Evan looked up to Lily, his eyes wide.
"Are you going to have a boy or girl?"
Lily shrugged.
"I don't know yet. It'll be a couple of months before I find out."
"I hope you have a boy," Evan said.
Lily chuckled. "You wouldn't want me to have a pretty little girl?"
"I guess a girl would be okay. When are you going to be leaving?"
"I plan to finish out this term."
She glanced around the room.
"Which means I need to pack up my classroom when school gets out this summer. It won't be my room next year."
"If you want any help, I can help you," he offered.
Lily smiled at Evan, noting his sincerity.
"Thanks, I appreciate the offer."
She glanced around the room again. All of her personal school supplies, the books, games, bulletin board art, reading rug, aquarium, posters, were all relatively new. The school supplies she had accumulated since first becoming a teacher almost a decade earlier had all been given away by her parents when they had thought she was dead. After accepting a class at the Frederickport Elementary School, she had purchased new items to replace what her parents had given away. Glancing around the room, she was torn as to what to do. Perhaps she should donate them to a new teacher, one who could not afford to purchase supplies for his or her room. Teachers didn't make a lot of money, but Lily was more fortunate than most. Not only had she married a wealthy man, but the settlement she had been awarded after her kidnapping had set her up for life.
providing she didn't spend her money foolishly. "Do you think the baby will be able to see ghosts?" Evan asked, disrupting Lily's train of thought.
"What?"
"Your baby. Marie told me when she was a baby she could see Eva," Evan told her.
"Ah, that's right. I remember hearing that. You know, I've even seen a ghost."
"You mean when Walt used to take you on a dream hop?" Evan asked. Lily grinned.
"I wasn't talking about seeing one in a dream. I was talking about seeing a ghost when I was wide awake. Over on Pilgrim's Point there was a ghost. Darlene Gusaroff. I saw her."
"I know about her. Eva said she's gone now, that she moved on."
"You sure know a lot about ghosts."
Evan nodded again. "And Walt's wife, the one who tried to kill him, she was at the cemetery, but Eva said she moved on too."
"I guess ghosts aren't meant to stick around indefinitely. Of course, there are always exceptions. Eva has been hanging around for quite a while."
"I wish my mom would have stuck around," Evan said glumly. Lily reached out and patted Evan's hand.
"But you know why she didn't, don't you?"
"Yeah. I was pretty little back then, and Walt said it would have confused me. People would have thought I was crazy."
Lily nodded. "Yep, pretty much. I imagine it was difficult for your mother to make that choice, but moms try to do what's best for their children."
"That's why you're staying home and not going back to school?" Evan asked.
"A lot of moms decide to keep working after they have babies. It doesn't make them bad moms. We just have to do what works for us. For me, it's staying home. And I'm luckier than most. I can afford to do it."
"I'm glad I got to have you as a teacher. You are my favorite teacher," Evan told her.
"Thanks." Lily thought Evan was being sweet, but told herself not to let it go to her head. After all, he was only in third grade, and he hadn't had that many teachers in his young life. After leaving the school a short time later, Lily went home, parked her car in the garage, and then walked across the street to Marlow House. Ian had gone to Portland and had taken Sadie with him, and Lily didn't expect him to return until the dinner hour. 30 minutes later, Lily sat with Walt and Danielle in the living room of Marlow House.
"You really aren't going to try to get your business license reinstated?" Lily asked Danielle after hearing what had happened.
"If I still wanted to operate the B&B, I suppose I would, but Walt and I have other ideas for the place. And in some ways, this makes it easier for me. Kind of forces my hand. I told Walt I should probably thank Pearl."
"Yeah, right," Lily scoffed.
"The woman is horrid, and I thought you loved running the B&B.
Walt stood up. "I'm going to let you two catch up while I go find Max. I need to have that talk with him."
"Talk with him?" Lily asked after Walt left the room.
"Max is having too much fun tormenting Pearl. He needs to realize she's dangerous," Danielle said.
"True, but I can't say I blame him. Now, back to the B&B. I thought you loved it."
"I did. We met some great people, but we also had our share of problems."
"Yeah, well, maybe a murder or two," Lily shrugged.
"And I hate to admit it. In some ways, Joe was right."
"Oh, no, please, don't say that," Lily groaned.
Danielle chuckled. "I don't mean right in how he thinks I need a keeper, although maybe I do."
She chuckled again and then grew serious.
"No, think about it. When I first decided to open the B&B, it was after I had inherited my aunt's estate and I was trying to start a new life after what had happened to Lucas and after selling our business. At the time, I had no idea my aunt's estate was worth far more than Renton had let on.
Or that you would be inheriting your cousin's estate, or finding the missing Thorndike or the gold coins," Lily added.
"Exactly. Initially, it was a way to generate income from this property. It sounded fun and would allow me to try something new. Use skills I hadn't really used before while still utilizing some of my marketing skills. But the main thing, I needed the business back then. I couldn't afford, or at least I didn't think I could afford to just move in here without doing something to make a living. But now you don't need to work? I kept telling myself how much I love baking and being a hostess, and I do, and how fun it was to meet new friends, like Will, Wayne, and Patricia and her brother. But then people from Clint's life showed up, and Walt and I found ourselves making breakfasts for guests we didn't even like, guests who were trying to blackmail us. That's just nuts. Not to mention Chris's uncles, Lily reminded her. Danielle nodded. Exactly. While we were in Hawaii, Walt and I started talking about it. Then I realized I had been trying to convince myself I wanted to keep the B&B open, trying to justify it all. But really, it's kind of silly. I'm not sure it's silly exactly, Lily argued. Yeah, it is. I'm no longer in a place where I need to run a business to survive. And while a B&B was a fun business, well, at least it was as long as someone wasn't trying to kill us, things are different now, much more different than when I first decided to open. I suppose they are. So what will you do? I can't see you just sitting around the house while Walt writes. I want to take a page from Chris. Chris? Pay it forward, Danielle explained. You've already donated a ton of money to Chris's foundation. Surely you aren't going to just give it all away like he is, are you? Chris isn't actually just giving all his money away, Danielle corrected. He's using it to generate more money so he can keep helping worthwhile causes. Is that what you plan to do? Lily asked. I did love running the B&B. It was fun, and I still want to do it. Lily frowned. Okay, you are confusing me. In some ways, Walt and I will still be running Marlow House as a B&B. Well, maybe not a B&B exactly. More like an inn, I suppose. You really are confusing me now. I thought you just told me you no longer have a business license. We aren't going to need a business license for what we intend to do, Danielle explained. And while I don't like to be perverse, it will be amusing when Pearl Huckabee realizes her plan backfired on her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.